Сайн байцгаана уу хүнд үзэгчдээ. Өнөөдөр орой манай De Facto нэвтрүүлгийн зочноор Канадын Forbes and Manhattan гэдэг банкны үндэслэгч туулзынхан дарга Стан Бхарти гэж оролцож байна.
Стан Бхарти Канадын Forbes and Manhattan банкны үүсгэн байгуулагч удирдлаг зөвлөлийн дарга Тус банкны санхүүгийн дэмжлэгтэй байгуулагдсан 40 гаруй компани дэлхийн 29 улсад уул уурхай болон бусад салбарт үйл ажиллагаа явуулж байна. Ноён Бхарти уул уурхайн салбарт маш амжилттай том төслүүдийг хэрэгжүүлж, өнгөрсөн хугацаанд 2 том төслийг нийт 5.6 тэрбум доллараар дэлхийн тэргүүлэх компаниудад худалдсан байна. Ноён Бхарти өөрийн удирдах ур чадвар, туршлахын тулгуурлан өнгөрсөн 4 жилийн хугацаанд санхүүгийн зах зээлээс 5 тэрбум долларын хөрөнгө босгожээ. Уул уурхайн салбарт 30 гаруй жил ажилласан туршлагатай. Одоогийн байдлаар 23 компани үйл ажиллагаанд гүйцэтгэх цэгрэл болон удирдах зөвлөлийн даргын хуваар идэвхтэй оролцож байна. Лондонгийн их сургуульд инженерийн чиглэлээр мастер зэрэг хамгаалсан.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
You have been founding several banks and have been investing in several countries, almost 30 countries, in mining. You are a mining engineer. You are also investing in Mongolia. Very fascinating story. Please tell us how come that and what are you doing in Mongolia?
Well, let me just, Jargal, just mention to you why we like mining and why we like going in different countries. Mm-hmm. We believe that we are in a bull cycle in commodities that started in 2001, and it's one of the super cycles that will last 10, 20 years. So we're very bullish on hard assets. After what we've seen in the financial world and what happened in the 80s and 90s, and the huge correction we saw in the financial world, and the emergence of countries like China, like Mongolia, Brazil, and the whole shift of power in Eastern Europe, we think that the bulk of the world is going to hard assets. Now, the most interesting and the most attractive, financially attractive hard assets are in emerging markets, like Mongolia. So we come into these countries and we set up offices here, we work with local people, and we take time to build relationships. Because as you know, each country has its own culture, its own way of operation, its own political issues that have to be dealt with. So we spend a lot of time doing that. And let me just tell you a little more about Mongolia. I came to Mongolia first time about 3 years ago. Mm-hmm. And we had some relationships. We then, over the last 3 years, have now established a full-time office here, very close to the White House. We have 35 professionals that work with us. Mm-hmm. We have two public companies that are listed in Toronto that have assets here, and one private company. And we have over 15 licenses in Mongolia in copper gold, in uranium, coal, phosphate. Mm-hmm. And we think that Mongolia is a very exciting country. I mean, where else do you get a country this size with the resource base you have with only 3 million people, less than 3 million people?
You said about the mining cycle. This is a very cyclical commodity market. Mm-hmm. And you said about 10 years and since 2000. Now it's about the end of the cycle?
No. These are super cycles. I think it's another 10 to 15 years to go.
Okay.
The last super cycle we saw in hard assets was really from 1966 to 1982 or 81. And I'm sure you know from your background in economics that at that time, of course, gold went to $1,000 an ounce.
Yes.
Oil went at that time to $40.
Yes.
And the price of copper, which used to be at 40 cents a pound, went to a dollar. We believe that since 1982, we have been in a bear, a negative cycle in commodities. Uh-huh. And if you know, from 1982 until 2001, we had almost 22 years of a negative cycle when oil fell to $8 a pound. Sorry, $8 a barrel.
Yes.
From $40. Gold went to as low as $250. Mm-hmm. And copper went back to 60 cents a pound.
And now this time, this circle is, the whole price wise is two or three times larger now.
Yes. And we think it's going to go higher. We think that the commodity cycle, first of all, the world population is growing.
Yes.
Secondly, the currencies, especially in Europe and in America, they're essentially getting debased because of the issues they've had in the financial world. And because they're getting reduced in value, people are going to gold primarily and hard assets.
So I think along with the gold, compare with copper and other minerals that Mongolia is rich of, mm-hmm. you think it has another 10 years good cycle?
Oh, yeah. Mongolia, let me tell you something about Mongolia. Mongolia, when I look at the asset base you guys have, mm-hmm. has the potential to be the next Canada. If you look at Canada, Canada grew on resources. Mm-hmm. When people think of Canada, they think of timber, mm-hmm. mining, oil and gas.
Yes.
And Mongolia, I don't know about the oil and gas so much and timber, but you certainly have some of the largest mining assets in the world.
And this is one issue that what we have under the ground. The second issue, how the Canadians made this underground asset into such asset that do not depend on even the very cyclical of those. Anyway, what we can do for that?
That is critical. And I think, you know, Mongolia is at a crossroads here. You've established a democratic system. You know, I've met some of the politicians here, and I think you're on the right track. I know there's elections coming next year. But these, even though we're in a super cycle, they don't last forever. So it's very important for Mongolia in the next 10 to 15 years to capitalize on this potential windfall that I think you can have here. Just not just the $7 or $8 billion that's being invested in Oyu Tolgoi, but the coal assets you have, the other assets. And what Canada did is Canada in the 40s and 50s and 60s really encouraged junior mining. And what junior mining, which is, when I say junior small mining companies, I mean mining companies that are listed on the Toronto Stock Exchange but have a market capitalization of less than $100-200 million. And so what that encouraged was lots of exploration, because people saw that finding good projects, listing them on a stock exchange, raising capital was attractive. And I think that's the best way for Mongolia, instead of just looking at the majors. Of course, the majors are important, the big companies, but you must also encourage the local entrepreneurs, the small Canadian, Australian, foreign companies to come here and start developing these projects. That's because exploration will eventually lead to several Oyu Tolgois. And if you look at $8 billion being injected, that's almost $3,000 per Mongolian citizen. That's a lot of money going into this country.
When the first junior companies come, they develop, they drill according to a standard, mm-hmm. they establish the reserve, right? And then after a certain level of work, they come to list the company. I mean, there are several companies who are doing that. Mm-hmm. In Australia and Canada, by Mongolians and the joint ventures, etc. How do you find that process in Mongolia today?
I think it's a very clean process, but it's a little cumbersome. I mean, you know, applying for the licenses, that process, it's fairly clean mm-hmm. and systematic, but it's somewhat cumbersome.
What do you mean?
Cumbersome meaning it takes some time.
Yeah, I understand.
You know, filing, for example, will take some time. That could be expedited, for example.
Yeah.
Let me give you an example of Brazil, uh-huh. which, again, another resource-based economy that's booming. Brazil mm-hmm. is growing at 10-12% a
yes,
year.
Yes, Brazil is a host of the largest veil company.
It is. And as you know, as probably you know, Forbes in Manhattan has invested close to $4 billion in Brazil. Mm. And the reason we have been able to do that is because the process is, there's so many companies that are encouraged to come in here, and what Brazil is looking for is not worried about the ownership. They're more worried about the asset being unlocked. In other words, if you explore and you spend the money to build the projects, the jobs will get created, and taxes will get paid,
but
and
the other
economy
hand,
will grow.
Yes, correct, absolutely. We need to know exactly how much we have, and where do we have, and we list, etc. But however, mining is not employing much people compared to other sector. So it is to go with creation of new jobs, new sectors. Mm-hmm. What do you think Mongolia can do that in this regard in diversifying economy?
I think the biggest thing that Mongolia can do when it is creating, when there's so much wealth coming to the country, is put money into infrastructure. Mm-hmm. Because, like I said, this window of 10, 15, 20 years will not last. And during this time, it's very important that you guys take the capital that's coming in taxes and invest it in the country, in schools, in hospitals, in infrastructure. Because when you look at Africa, again, as an example, Africa in the 70s went through a huge boom. And some of the countries, like Zambia, they nationalized. Mm-hmm. lot of other countries in Africa nationalized. Mm-hmm. But nationalization, in fact, worked against Zambia, because what happened is it became the mining industry became very bureaucratic. Mm-hmm. So then in the 90s, they went to privatize the industry again. Mm-hmm. And what they didn't do in the 70s was take the capital mm-hmm. from private enterprise and invest it in the country. Mm-hmm. And so in the 80s and 90s, countries like Zambia went through a very difficult time.
So what you're saying is in some African countries, which we in a way called with complete disease, they have been doing first private companies, then they have nationalized it, then they have to go back. Very long process.
Well, what happens, you see, is that whenever the resource prices go up, I mean, almost in all emerging markets, there's this sense, this is our asset.
Yes.
The country should nationalize it.
Exactly.
We saw that trend in the 70s, not in Zambia, uh-huh. even in Canada. Uh-huh. The province of Saskatchewan uh-huh. nationalized the mining industry.
Okay.
So it was not just in Zambia. Uh-huh. Brazil went through this phase. Chile nationalized uh-huh. the copper industry yes. in the 70s. Argentina. Uh-huh. So this trend comes. But what I'm saying is when you look back historically,
yes.
that nationalization was not productive.
So do you think that by this logic, Mongolia will be nationalizing more of this?
I obviously can't speak for Mongolia. I think the trends in Mongolia actually are very positive. Your politicians have done a very good job with the democratic process, the way I see it, from looking from outside. You know, because some of the countries after the collapse of the Soviet Union, when Mongolia gained its independence, it really became truly a democratic country. You've got two parties here, you know, elections are held. I know there's elections next year. So I don't think nationalization will come. But I just want to mention that as a point, that in almost every country like Mongolia, this issue will be tabled.
No, just my concern is because we are, I mean, from your perspective, thank you for, as an investor, you coming into Mongolia, working and investing into Mongolia, believing in us. On the other hand, from Mongolian perspective, we see in the country, along with discovery of large deposits, you know, international capital market going on, then we have a larger and larger distance in inequality mm-hmm. of income.
Mm-hmm.
So the people's feeling is not that much happy because mm-hmm. not everybody mm-hmm. is benefiting.
Mm-hmm.
Well, how do you see that?
Yes, that's and you know, that problem and that issue you will have to deal with. And I think one way to deal with it is a lot of the countries say, okay, we will own a percentage of the project. My suggestion is that instead of owning a percentage of the project, that there'd be revenue coming to the government from two sources. One is taxes. The second is if you look at the wealth created, for example, by a company like Ivanhoe in the stock market, it's huge, even before the mine's in production. So I think governments like Mongolia should participate more in the public markets to unlock their value, rather than waiting for cash flow to come from operations, because
the process of the Mongolians made a law, obviously, as an investor, you know, this 34% for strategic mm-hmm. investment. For strategic deposits. How do you find that?
I think the principle makes sense, but at the end, the person, the average Mongolian is saying, how does that 34% benefit me?
Exactly.
And the challenge the government has is the cash flow from that 34% ownership is maybe 4, 5, 6 years away. Because from the time, you know, when you find a project to develop it, and it goes into production, and you repay the capital, it's a long process.
And yet you have to invest 34% because you own 34%, right?
Yes, you have to put up your capital.
So the other option is, which was originally before that in the case of Mongolia, before we have not considering this public participation, mm-hmm. we instead of come, do it, cover cost, then we share. Before covering cost, we will take tax that much, after that much. And that was in particular our law in petroleum production mm-hmm. sharing contract. If there is a similar things in mining, in how does it work?
Well, in most countries in mining, essentially, because mining is a highly capital intensive industry.
Yes. And it's a risky industry.
It's a risky industry. And the commodity cycle, even though we're in a bull cycle in commodities, they're very volatile.
Uh-huh.
You know, gold went to, as you saw,
sure.
what happened in 2008.
Sure.
So the program that I've seen the best is where governments just encourage companies to come in and invest and really create jobs and rely on taxes. That's the two simplest forms of revenue for the governments.
But on the other hand, in mining, in just simple mining, the initial processing, producing level, jobs are not created much unless you create more additional value-added process, part of value chain.
But that happens automatically. For example, it will make no sense for a company like ours, for example, that is going to do copper gold, not to process the copper gold here. Uh-huh. We will have to put a plant up, a concentrator. Yeah, the smelter will ship the concentrate out, but the plant will have to be put here. And even if you just take mining, the jobs that mining, just creating, mining creates are huge. And, you know, Mongolia is it's a big country, but it's a small population. So you don't need a large tax revenue really to increase the standard of living. Your GDP in this country is going to grow 7-8% a year. The challenge for the government is to make sure that, you know, that the average person benefits. For example, you've seen the I was reading an article today in the paper about, you know, Occupy Wall Street.
Yes.
1% of Americans today have 25% of the U.S. income. And that is doubled from where it was 25 years ago. So that disparity is causing a lot of difficulties.
99% of the wealth.
Yes. So imagine 1% of the population of the U.S. gets 25% of the total U.S. income. And 25 years ago, it was half that. They only got 12%. So in the last 20 years, from 1982 to the, during this financial growth, really the top 1% has just got wealthier. And one has to be careful to make sure that the wealth is evenly distributed.
See, even in the country like the U.S., have allowed that process went on. What can be done here, like a country, young democracy like Mongolia?
Well, I think the models that work in countries like Mongolia are a good capitalist model with a good socialist overlay, like we have in Canada, for example.
Yes.
We have very good health systems.
Yes.
We have good unemployment insurance.
Yes.
You know, our taxes, while we complain about our taxes, still, so the disparity between the, what we call the haves and the have-nots is much smaller.
Yes.
And I think it's very important.
So what is, can be done here, I mean, you have been certainly observing, what do we start? Of course, we need the good public governance, transparent system. What else? What kind of incentives?
I think it's more having governments that really commit to spending money on infrastructure and on policies that benefit the average Mongolian, not in Ulaanbaatar so much, but 500 miles away with his, in his tent and, you know, in, with his pasture. That, those kind of programs, it's very important that Mongolia realize that those are its real roots.
I understand, but however, we cannot lay a whole road to 300 kilometers away to Gir.
No, you cannot. But the government program, for example, the governments, and again, I don't know the specific programs that the government has here, but I'm saying the government programs in countries like Mongolia, while you're democratic and capitalistic, should have a socialist overlay. The main goal of the government should be to make sure that the basic needs of the average person are looked after, and that is shelter, health care, and basic food.
Yes. I mean, relatively, this country in that sense, not so bad. Of course, we have a poor people we need to feed, but overall, the living standard we want to increase. Could you give us some example of a very successful story of those countries you have been working from developing countries who had been done fairly well?
Well, I think the best example is Brazil.
Brazil, okay.
The middle class of Brazil has increased substantially. And so what that does when the middle class... When I started, we started investing in Brazil in 1995. And I still remember going there. Inflation was running at 20%. The Brazilian real, their local currency, was in turmoil. So what they did is, they did two or three things. One is they controlled their inflation. That was step one.
How?
They controlled their inflation by initially by increasing the rate, increasing the interest rate, and obviously reducing the money flow.
Yes.
Once they did that, then they invested a lot in hard assets, in the infrastructure of the country, and in mining, in oil and gas. If you look at, for example, the...
By private, mostly sectors.
All private. There is, obviously, for example, Petrobras is 50% owned by the government, the largest oil company in Brazil, but the other 50% is listed in New York, and it trades. So they invested a lot in the assets of the country. And when you invest in the assets of the country, that forces roads to be built, bridges to be built, power stations to be built, For example, if we're developing a phosphate mine we have in Mongolia, which is near the Russian border, there's no infrastructure there. The phosphate grade is quite interesting. So the first thing we'll have to do is look at a power plant, a road. So why not use our capital, together with perhaps some government support, to jointly build the roads, the power plants. And that creates all the jobs.
That's
and
what we call it PPP.
That's right, the three.
And that's what Brazil did?
Brazil does a lot of that.
So what
Canada does a lot of that.
Basically, you get the foreign investors or private investors investing into infrastructure, and they got paid after.
They invest in infrastructure. Sometimes they jointly invest with the government. Mm-hmm. So that's a big plus. I need a power plant to start the mine up. Uh-huh. But I don't want to put up all the $1 billion capital. Mm-hmm. So if I go to the government says, okay, we'll put up half the capital, or Brazil has the Brazilian Development Bank that will lend for infrastructure projects.
Where the Brazilian Development Bank takes money from?
From the government. They're basically...
The government is taking it from the tax revenue, or...?
Yes, government is taking it. The government, it's owned by the government, the Brazilian Development Bank. Mm-hmm. And so it essentially lends money for infrastructure projects and encourages infrastructure projects. If you look at the middle class in Brazil, it's growing at the rate of 10 to 20 million people are moving into what I call the lower middle class to the upper middle class. And that in Brazil means buying a fridge, buying a car, first time owning a home. Yeah. You know, it's not big money, but it's enough that the guy suddenly feel he wants to get a second television.
Yes.
That kind of stuff, and Brazil has been very smart in investing in that. Yeah. And if you look at Lula, for example, who is one of the most successful presidents, his program has always been democracy, capitalism, but with a strong social overtone.
Yes.
Taxes are relatively high in Brazil.
Mm. So what do you own in Brasilia? What kind of asset?
We have lots of assets in Brazil. We've got gold in Brazil. Mm. We've got potash. We've got oil in Brazil.
$4 billion you have invested.
Over the last 10 years or so.
Okay. Your bank, Forbes in Manhattan, who are shareholders?
It's a family-owned bank, so I'm the shareholder. It's
how
private.
How big is the asset?
Well, what our model is that we find good projects in mining and oil and gas, we invest in them, and then we take them public, typically on the Toronto Stock Exchange.
By each project?
Each project.
Is there a separate name
yes.
for that particular
We have
project?
28 companies listed on the Toronto Stock Exchange.
28?
Yes.
What is your total capitalization now on Toronto Exchange?
It's about $5 billion.
$5 billion. Yeah. And with this?
It used to be 10, but we sold a very large iron ore company 4 months ago to a large steel company in the U.S. Mm.
In U.S.?
In the, yeah.
Iron, we talk about, just another question about the economies of scale in this country. Mm-hmm. Now we talk about complex of industrial production. Maybe you have heard about the sanction on the way to China, the block in area. We want to create a complex that will bring iron from the north, copper from this Gobi, and all together will bring water from somewhere and then make smelter there and then a steel production. How realistic does it sound?
I have not followed that project carefully. But, you know, the principle, if really the government gets behind it and the politicians commit to it, it's a good principle. Because, you know, in some ways you're landlocked and you could say we've got two powerful countries, China and Russia. On the other hand, both those countries need you. And if you could use their assets to build a base in Mongolia, I think that's very smart.
Well, it is not that easy to use their asset. Now we are very much, everybody's in hurry up making the South Gobi, this sort of industrial complex. And we want to raise funds, you know, we want to borrow debt financing, and then we will pay anyway, all right? Mm-hmm. And why? And then almost everything goes to China. The question is, just to supply one big market, why we have to borrow all this money? How about this country also, along with the investors, playing under our rule, creating everything, the asset, and they buy after, and from that asset they... Otherwise, we will have a big risk like Nigeria had before. Do you have... I borrowed and you cannot pay after because there is no market. It's there.
The commodity.
How do you think about that?
It's a question every people in every government faces, whether you borrow and believe in the future and that things will grow. I think it's unlikely that you'll get a big country to come in and say, we'll put up all the capital so that Mongolia doesn't have to borrow. I think as long as you borrow within reason.
However, that should be sort of risk sharing, because we depend on only China now. We will 100% to sell them. They will say one day, sorry, we cannot make.
But you know, the world, I think dependence on China for to buy your products is not that bad.
It's not that bad.
They're the ones partly creating the higher prices. I mean, the reason iron ore is today at 100, iron ore in 1982 was at $26 a ton of concentrate. Uh-huh. It's today $140, $150 a ton. Partly it's demand from China. So China is really also indirectly by buying your product creating wealth in Mongolia that's helping the standard of living of the average Mongolian to go higher.
Well, however, still it is dependence on one market. And
it
really
is.
To watch the market, when we say the market's on political system, economic system, demographic, et cetera, I mean, that's something that we have to think over. All right, how about you think, what do you think about the railway system we talk about, the gauge system, and the network? Probably you are familiar with.
Yeah. Just before I address that, let me address one thing. Coming from Canada, mm-hmm. of course, Canada is very dependent on the U.S. Mm-hmm. And for years, they're our largest trade partner. And you know, you look at the U.S., 300 million people, the world's largest economy. Canada is, you know, seventh or eighth largest economy in the world, only 30 million people, so a tenth. And we pretty much, Canada lives within 200 miles of the U.S. border, most of the population. Mm-hmm. And for a long time, Canada said, no, we don't want to be that dependent on the U.S. We had all these programs. At the end, it's the reality of who we are. And so most of the programs that Canada tried to get away from the dependence of the U.S. have not worked. And so today, we have a free trade agreement with the U.S. They're our largest partner, and it has lots of benefits for Canada.
That's okay. And the plus, both countries are democratic.
Both, they are. They're both democratic, and there's a sense of, you know, language is a common language. Common heritage is a big factor.
Yes.
Absolutely.
And
those are positive factors.
It's a great government with great public transparency and
yes,
a lot of things to do on that. Okay, you know, you have been visiting Mongolia and you're 29 countries traveling all around. How do you fit into this busy schedule?
I travel a lot because you see, the one key thing we've done in Forbes in Manhattan, because when you look at how do we get our assets, anybody can go and pay $1 billion and buy a great asset, right? Our strength is to find assets in emerging markets that are somewhat undervalued, put our own capital and build them. So what we do is we have a key board of advisors. Larry King is one of our advisors on our advisory board. He just retired from CNN, as you know. The other thing is that as a principal, as chairman, I go and personally make sure that I'm meeting top people. You know, tomorrow we have a meeting with some of your government officials. You know, I'm here for 2 days. We've got some receptions. And that's very important because for my employees, I want to send a message that we are. But also for people like yourselves here, I want to tell the Mongolian people that this country, our investment is important.
That's exactly the message we want to give to Mongolians today, that you are one of those investors who is making the changes in the country. And this is very important. I think the great majority of Mongolians want to see investors coming, doing their businesses. Mm-hmm. We want to create that conditions. They are happy. We are happy. You are paying taxes. And that, I think, win-win situation, right? So you are traveling a lot. And do you fly yourself, private jet or?
I have a jet. You know, for long flights like that, I fly commercial. But short flights, particularly within South America, we have a lot of businesses out there.
Then when you fly all the time, living 10,000 kilometers
living in the air. Yeah, my kids are grown up, so it's not so bad. My kids are grown up, but I would say half my time in the traveling.
Okay, you studied in London, right?
Yes.
Before that, you studied in Russia.
Yes.
Why you have decided to go to London after Russia?
Well, you know, it was a total coincidence, actually. I mean, and I know some of your viewers speak Russian, so dobry den.
Dobry den.
And what happened was, I'm Indian by birth, so I got a scholarship to go to the, at that time, the Soviet Union,
good
in the time
you.
Of Brezhnev, because the Soviet Union used to give all kinds of
Brezhnev
scholarships.
Brezhnev and Indira Gandhi were good
friends. They were good friends, absolutely right.
Big scholarships.
Yeah, big.
Among, yeah.
They allocated 30 seats every year to Indian students.
Wow, I see.
So it was, and it was very generous, because they paid for your flight from India.
Yeah.
They paid, at that time, a stipend of 90 rubles a month, which was a lot of money. And they paid free education, free accommodation, and it was for 5 years, so I was very lucky. And then when I was there, my family from India moved to Britain, so that's why I ended up going to Britain after that and doing my master's at the University of London.
Okay, who are your parents?
My parents are Indian, they're both Indian.
Yes, and by profession or by business?
My father is a psychologist.
Wow.
And my mother, who passed away, was a school teacher.
Aha.
So it was kind of a coincidence that, and then in the 60s, the British government and the United Kingdom was encouraging immigrants because they were desperately short of professional laborers,
exactly.
Or professionals. So they encouraged my father as a psychologist, my mother as a school teacher to go in and teach. Mm-hmm. And by the way, talking about our general discussion, just one other point I want to make is that immigration has been a big, big factor in countries like Brazil, and in countries like U.S., Canada, because it does two things. One is it becomes entrepreneurship.
Yes.
Because when an immigrant comes, he's hungry, and he wants to, and I see one of the things I see in Mongolia is you have a lot of foreigners here, which is a very good sign. A lot of people, you know, in spite of your challenging traffic, a lot of people are live in Ulaanbaatar.
Well, hopefully our city planning cannot stay like this anymore. I think
you got to put more roads
point.
In.
Yes.
You got to put more
I think with
roads
the more
in.
Extension, a little bit, we need to be smarter and to have better road and more people. And when the highly paid executives, foreigners, come to the country, we create more restaurants, other services, and
absolutely.
That's what we see visualize, and hopefully. Thanks to guys like you, investors, I think we will make Mongolia another Qatar or some similar countries to do.
We're proud to be here in Mongolia. In fact, right, you mentioned Qatar is interesting because right after here I'm going to Qatar for two days.
Okay.
But that's mostly to raise capital for some of our projects, not to invest in Qatar because Qatar doesn't need our money. You know, they've got some of the largest gas reserves in the world. But it's interesting, though, if you look at how Qatar has deployed its capital, they've been very smart. The first thing they've done is they've made sure that every Qatari has a basic standard of living. And
how many Mongolians do you employ now?
I don't have the exact number, but I'm guessing at least 3/4 are Mongolians. There's only about 4 or 5 foreigners in the office. Foreigners, I mean, okay. Canadians and, you know, America, we've got Australians.
How do you find Mongolians?
Some of them I speak Russian with. They're, you know, some of the older geologists.
Okay.
It's a lot of fun. I speak Russian with them.
Okay.
The younger ones I find very smart. Some of them have studied, in fact, in the U.S. and have come back to Mongolia, which is another very good sign.
That's very good. We call it repatriates.
Repatriates. That's a very good sign.
Sort of, we were, before competing with international organizations for better Mongolians, qualifications,
mm-hmm.
and now we are competing with, as a Mongolian company, we are competing guys like you. So that gives better living and conditions for Mongolian professionals and hopefully later on other blue-collar workers, etc. And how much you going to spend a year in Mongolia now, invest money?
Right now we're spending between $10 to maybe $20 million a year.
A year.
But that will grow next year substantially because we're accelerating our exploration programs. And then one of our gold mines could go into production in the next 2 to 3 years. So if that happens, then suddenly it'll be a $50 to $100 million investment.
Oh, okay.
So that'll be, yeah. So we see Mongolia as a key country because the resources you have are very large. And like you said, you do need rail. You need infrastructure.
Before the end of our conversation, I would like to ask you a question about this geological reporting differences between Russia and Canada.
Mm-hmm.
And Canada has this 43-101.
Yes.
And they Russian. What the principal difference of these two reports?
Well, the first of all, the 43-101 came as a result of a scandal that happened in Canada with a company called Briex.
Uh-huh.
Briex was a gold company in Indonesia that had a market capitalization of $2 or $3 billion.
On Toronto.
And then we found out in 1997 that the representations that were made were a scam. They were actually putting gold in the rock samples. They were actually putting, and there were some engineers from Philippines who were employed, geologists, they were putting gold in there and reporting it falsely. So then there was a commission set up by the Ontario Securities Commission, and they came to the conclusion that you need to have a technical report signed by a professional to make a representation. Mm. Before 1999, you could just file a report, say, I've got 5 million ounces of gold. You didn't have to have a professional. So that's the history of it. So they, and then they set certain standards. The Russian way of reporting, I think, is very conservative, but it is still from the time when I was a student. It's the old time, you know. And so I think that it could be upgraded to the Australian or the South African.
Have they done the Russians? Have they improved their system now?
Yes, they have. But you know, the qualifications still go back to the Soviet times.
Uh-huh.
The
because in our report, what the Russian geologists left, certain drillings were made, say, for very much evaluation, production, the reserve evaluation, they were made the drilling the distance of 100 meter.
Mm-hmm.
And then the Canadian, the 43101 requires at least to be a 50 meter.
Yes.
This
yes.
sort of very...
Some of it is, you know, it's a gray area. Uh-huh. For example, if you're drilling for gold, you need 50 meters. If you're drilling for phosphate or for potash, you need 500 meters because and coal you need much longer distances because of the consistency.
Because it's disturbed disbursement of
exactly.
the rocks.
Yes. But the Soviet system, I think, is conservative. And in fact, the one thing I found somewhat frustrating in Mongolia is a lot of the Soviet data is not here. They took it back and it's often sitting in university somewhere in Russia.
Mm.
So
maybe
I think
it's easier to send somebody there to bring it back.
You know what, if you could get the data back, because I think the Russians did a lot of good work here, a lot of good technical work, but it's much more difficult to find that than I thought. And if we could find that,
which system you are reporting today? In this Canadian system? Or
We report only in the Canadian system.
Do you report your exploration data to Mongolian authorities?
No, generally we have to do some filing, so we have an exploration license.
But at the level, you estimate certain reserve of your deposit, then do you report at a certain level to Mongolian authority that you found that much copper or gold?
Yeah, whatever is required. So there's two licenses. There's exploration license, as you know, in Mongolia, and then after you've done your exploration and done your filing and your technical reports, then you get a mining license.
Uh-huh.
So during that exploration phase, we have to report all the work that's done,
which
we do. But when we file, because a lot of the companies are listed on Toronto Stock Exchange, we have to file to 43101 standards.
Uh-huh.
So we file those reports.
So then before you receive the production license, you also give all that to Mongolian authority, that's the reserve we have,
of
and
course.
You want to mine it.
And a lot of it is public. Because,
yep.
you know, it's because we're on the Toronto Stock Exchange, it's all public.
That's
anyway,
the whole thing.
It's on CEDAR, which
so
is
it's
a website.
So you do double work at once.
That's
you
right.
Report here and there. Alan, thank you very much.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. And once again, you know, I'm very encouraged and proud to be here and pleased to be here. And I think Mongolia in the next 5 to 10 years, I think will become a great emerging country.
Thank you. Have a good luck.
Thank you.